the trail again and again. Hiking and hunting and fishing the land. Time is time we'll spend. We'll take it to the delta.
Habitat management and controlling the exploding hog populations go hand in hand with managing the resources of the state of Mississippi.
Without the help of farmers and landowners alike, hogs will soon take over completely and further impact our ecological and economical makeup of the state. This episode looks at the huge problem hogs are creating for Mississippians and the ways that they can be controlled. The wild hog population across the state is exploding. It has been for a number of years now, and we've seen hogs pop up in areas where we wouldn't have expected to see wild hogs. You're seeing hogs now not only in the agriculture landscape, but also around cities across the state of Mississippi, causing thousands upon thousands of dollars of damage to landscaping, to agriculture fields, to wildlife habitat. They can do damage to golf courses, can do damage to sensitive areas such as marshes, such as the beaches on the Mississippi Gulf Coast, such as levees along the Mississippi River. So they're not limited to one area of the state, and they're not limited to the amount of damage that they can cause.
Originally, North America was not native to any sort of hog, pig-like species at all. Any of the family Suidae, which is what the wild hog is in. So the original introduction was by Hernando de Soto in 1539. He introduced them to what's now current day Tampa Bay, Florida, and they were domestic hogs that were brought over for food purposes.
So they carried swine with them to use for food, and there's also evidence in certain places they turned swine loose that maybe someday they could, you know, establish a population for food resources.
They were very hardy animals, they lived a long time, they matured quickly, and they had, the reproduction was there as far as making a lot more and having a lot more to eat. The second introduction was actually of the Eurasian wild boar, thought to be from the Black Forest region of Germany in the late 1890s in New Hampshire. So the purpose for that, rather than for food purposes, was for more of a game opportunity, a hunting opportunity.
Wild hogs, this is not just the wild boar that came from Europe. This is a hybrid, essentially. So there are some places in Mississippi that truly do have Eurasian or Russian wild boar. Most of them are what we call feral hogs, which means they are descendants from a domesticated hog that had been bred for or selected for increased reproductive rate. So in North America, with this exotic hog that we have compared to the reproductive rates in Europe, there's a vast difference.
The reproduction of wild hogs is very high. They can have up to 14 per litter, usually average 4 to 6. But when we think about our white-tailed deer and how many we have in the state, and we're talking about a reproduction of 1 to 2, in very rare cases, 3. And so when you talk about that type of reproduction, the parental investment that they give to make sure that as many of those piglets get to maturity and to breeding age as possible, you're talking about a very, very rapid reproduction.
So we have an animal, the wild hog, that literally reproduces at a rate double or triple that of white-tailed deer. That's the biggest problem. Furthermore, there are no predators. Because it's an exotic species, there's no really large predators that are going to control the populations. We're the large predator.
The best method for control of wild hogs is trapping. That is the number one best method to be able to remove large numbers of pigs off of a property at one time. A lot of people want to go out and they want to hunt pigs, they want to shoot pigs. While it is a fun sport to go hunting wild hogs, it's not a great removal method to remove large numbers off the pigs to try to eliminate those populations.
When you want to remove wild hogs, you have to take what's called the complete sounder approach. What that means is, you don't want to remove a few individuals out of that sounder. A sounder is nothing more than a social group that they stay in. And that could be from four or five individuals all the way up to 20 or 30 or 40 individuals in a sounder. But you want to try to remove that entire sounder if you can, and that's how you start to lower your population numbers.
And the high success rate comes from conditioning hogs to use bait. Once you stop pressuring hogs through hunting, once you stop shooting at them, and you condition these hogs to come to bait, it is very easy to construct a large corral trap where all those hogs will enter it, and then you can drop the door, and some people literally will catch 20 to 30 hogs in one night, in one catch. So that's the way you can make a lot of gain from a little bit of effort.
What we've done right here, we've been baiting these hogs, but we caught them all in a large trap right down the road. But what we want to do when we set these traps is, first thing we'll do is we'll bait them and not set a trigger. We'll wait, we'll set a camera up on it and make sure all your hogs are going in the trap before you actually set the trigger. If you got hogs standing outside the trap and you have one go in it, he fires the trap, you won't get these that are outside. Hog is a smart animal. And when you bait them around the edge of the trap on the inside. If you throw it all over the place and you have bait at your trigger, they get used to it, they'll run in there and they'll run all the way to the back of the trap, fire it, you'll have hogs outside. But if you start baiting them, especially when you first set, we set this trigger last night, but we won't bait past half the trap. We get them used to feeding, they'll stop right here, and they'll line up like cows coming in. But when we want to catch them, we'll put bait all the way back to the trigger. The hogs have gotten so used to it, they'll line up as they come in. And they'll just keep eating all that corn until they get back to your trigger. And all we're doing right here is, once they bump it, we got hogs. And what I want to do is try to catch them all, you know, as many as possible. So patience is one of the most virtues of catching hogs, especially a lot of them.
You know, when I first started trapping, what I was doing is I was putting bait in the trap, and then I'd set the trap, and I'd catch one or two, and the rest of them, you know, weren't going in the trap, and all I was doing was educating the rest of them.
We do have an active trapping program. We're trapping typically outside of the hunting seasons because we find that's the best time for us to be able to do it. We have less disturbance around our traps at that point, and we can be much more successful as well.
The USDA does actually do a lot of trapping also on their lands and some on private lands as well, but they also conduct what's called aerial gunning operations, which this is with a helicopter done by a shooter, so from the air shooting down on the ground, and it's a very effective control effort. Unfortunately, it also has its limitations. You're limited by the time of year because of the foliage on the trees. You have to do it, usually the most common times to do it are very late winter and early spring because there's no open hunting seasons then and all the leaves are still off the trees and you can be very effective. It's also limited by habitat. For example, the marshes down in the southern parts of the state and those are much more, they lend themselves a lot better to that type of management than let's say bottomland hardwoods or CRP where you have, you know, lots of trees packed in a small area and there's just not many areas to be able to get a shot.
They are certainly an omnivore. They'll eat anything available. They will eat deer fawns every chance they come across, and they also displace white-tailed deer by eating the same food sources such as acorns and a lot of the forbs out there. So reducing those pig numbers will also help in improving deer herds.
Yeah, hogs have affected my property in a lot of ways. Number one, there's no question that they compete with the deer for acorns and food. You know, I'll have a 10-acre food plot. Sometimes you'll have a third of that food plot just completely rooted up. And I know that the deer population, it seems to me around here, is not what it used to be. And I think the hogs have a lot to do with it. And then I planted pine trees on 20 acres 2 years ago. And I'm really anxious to see in another year or so when those trees come out over the weeds, how many of those trees were destroyed and damaged by the hogs. I also planted hardwoods, 8,000 hardwoods down there 4 or 5 years ago, and there's no question that they destroyed a lot of the hardwoods that I planted.
We meet with so many landowners that thought this was really novel. This was really neat to have something else they could hunt throughout the year. They were gonna have just a few every now and again hogs on the property. And I will talk with some of these people and literally after 3 or 4, sometimes 5 years, Now it's more than they can control, more than they can handle.
The Mississippi Department of Wildlife, Fisheries, and Parks has made a great effort to try to patrol the roads, patrol the properties, and make sure this illegal transportation is not taking place, because it is such a problem when we talk about agricultural crops, when it is such a problem when we talk about disease transmission of brand new areas to possibly naive populations.
Hogs carry a number of diseases that are harmful both to native wildlife, to livestock, and some of them are detrimental to humans as well.
And the ones that are probably the most concerned to us are leptospirosis, which is a bacterial disease that can affect cattle, dogs, horses, many species, and it affects the kidneys and is passed through the urine so that the organism can survive in water, in streams and or ponds. So if you have a hog frequenting the ponds on your property and then you go swimming, you have the opportunity to contract the disease. You can also contract it by directly contacting the hogs if you hunt hogs and butcher them. If you're not wearing appropriate protective clothing, gloves at least, the bacterium can actually invade cuts on your hands. So that's a real problem. If I was to handle the hogs, either alive or dead, I would wear plastic protective gloves. You can pick them up in the any drugstore around and to protect your hands. If you are butchering the hogs, I would certainly wear some kind of protective clothing that can be washed and sanitized, bleached, after use.
If you don't have them, you count yourself lucky. You're going to get them, and it's just a matter of when you do, do everything you can to get after them and get rid of them before they start multiplying and do the damage that they'll do.
We've got areas of the state we don't have wild hogs yet. And one of the best places to be able to do a real big impact on wild hogs is when you first see them on a property. When you first notice them on a property, that's when to attack. And if we can do that on some of these areas where we're not seeing huge hog numbers, we can start to make an impact across the state of Mississippi.
You know, I like to liken it to management of cockroaches, management of termites. You know, there's no specific number of wild hogs that you want on your property to control them. You want them eradicated, you want them all gone. And so, you know, that's the same type of paradigm that has to be taken to look at wild hogs, rather than, well, we have the numbers where we want them. Well, unless that number is zero, no you don't.
For over 70 years, Mississippi Outdoors Magazine has served the readers of the Magnolia State. The magazine contains interesting features such as wildlife photography and solar tables. Subscriptions to the magazine are very inexpensive. And when you subscribe, you'll receive 6 bi-monthly issues containing articles on hunting and fishing in the state, public lakes, state parks, and our wildlife management areas. For more information, call our toll-free number at 1-888-874-5785.
We're here in Covington County at Full Flight Hunting Preserve, right outside of Collins. We're going to be doing an early quail release hunt. It should be a lot of fun, a lot of excitement. Some good birds getting up. And we're going to see if we can do our job today. This man promised us we're going to have a lot of birds to shoot at, but we're going to see if we can take care of them.
Dollar shot, John? How are we playing for today?
Whatever you want. Pick a number and triple it.
Never bet with a man who says that.
So Steve, tell us a little about Full Flight Hunting Preserve.
It's a small place. People can come hunt half a day, all day. It's open pine timber, some open shots, little pastures and stuff. And it's a lot of fun. I grew up hearing stories about wild birds and bird hunting and never got to experience, because when I got old enough, it was wild birds were gone. And stayed on my mind for a long time, and I've been doing this for 10 years. That's Frisk and Bo. That's, they 10 months old. I'm using some pointer dogs. They're 10 months old, and Brittany's. And the Brittany's is a year old, and they come along pretty good. I train my own dogs.
We should have a pointer.
I start about the end of October when it starts cooling off, and I go all the way through the second Saturday in March. I hunt every day except Sundays. I can handle up to 9-10 people. I've got 3 courses. A lot of shooting goes on in a small place.
If they come, they're gonna shoot.
They're gonna shoot. A lot.
Y'all ready?
Uh-huh.
There he is right there. Get him, John.
Y'all ready?
Yep.
I'm excited about going quail hunting. As a kid, my dad loved quail hunting. And we used to quail hunt on horseback, but this is back in the 60s. I was a little kid, and we'd get off the horses, and I'd hold the horses while they'd go shoot the birds. And it's some of my fondest memories. By far, the favorite part of the hunt is watching the dogs. That is the greatest joy of the hunt.
Pepper dust is that one. Little close.
Little close there. Good shot.
Walk on up there.
Thing flew parallel with that pine tree. I had to look around him.
It gets a little more challenging than these pines, you know.
Well, the pine tree, that bird, when he got up, he seen that pine tree, got behind it, flew straight away. That little big old bush got me the last time. I got to stagger my position a little better. Well, John, we got about the same drop on our guns because we both shot the exact same time.
Good shot on that tree.
I seen that.
Oh,
good shot.
John, come across. Good shot.
That's the Okatoma Creek there. That's Okatoma.
A lot of water moving through it today, huh?
Yep.
I am not on my game today.
I sure hope you catch fish better than you do shoot birds.
I see we got one of these guys today. Yeah, I'm fixing to bear down on it now. John, we got to do better. I'm supposed to have quail for dinner tonight. Got dinner for one. Pretty good at fishing. Not as good as shooting trees, I guess. And this is for Mr. Bush right here, look. You know, I'm glad Rusty Poole called me out on that because headshot, baby. Look at here. Shot, John.
Good shot.
Round one didn't go too well. I mean, we got 20 out of 60 birds.
Well, I'm not sure we've seen
about 60 birds. Well, I don't think we hadn't either, but I mean, we had a few groups. John actually got a double. The only double I got was two pine trees. But we're gonna strip off some clothes. This warmed up really fast, and we're gonna go out this afternoon. I mean, he on the second run, and we're gonna do it. Yeah, I feel better already.
Yeah, I got two young Britneys. They was born last January.
So they're a year old. Get it?
A little slower pace, a little moving,
yeah,
a little slower.
They hunt closer.
Come back down wind to try and get on it, huh? Got him on the second.
Might need to start shooting that second shell first.
Take that second one first. Here. Good boy. Good deal. Good deal.
Good shot, John.
Shooting to the left.
Way left.
Way left. Shot.
Good shot.
Who's the man?
Now we're doing our job. It's amazing. We came right through here. That didn't.
They got to catch that wind just right. In the nose.
Was that you?
Two shots sounded just like one.
You didn't shoot.
At the exact same time, we both shot. And we both.
Rusty.
Yeah, y'all both shot.
Yeah.
Oh, he did?
I could tell it was two shots went off.
But it was, I mean, we got the same throwdown, you know what I mean? We got some double shooting, son of a gun.
Y'all getting good the later we get.
I mean, we both shoot the exact same moment. You going to the tree?
John. Good shot.
Our percentage has gone up, John.
Never leave on a miss.
What a fun time we had here this morning in Covington County, right outside of Collins at Full Flight Hunting Preserve. The birds flew well, and we've done our job, and now it's time to go home and have a quail dinner.
Time we'll spend.